recap on what I said last Sunday before I can build on it tonight briefly. It might not be exhaustive, for it is just a midweek service. The book of Matthew, chapter number 10, from verses 32. I want to read this scripture. Identify your number one enemy. Who is your real enemy number one? Who is the person that I need to fight first? We know that the devil is our enemy. We know about principalities and powers. The problem is that we don't know where they actually live. If we were to know the address, we just go there and deal with them once and for all. They don't give us their personal numbers and their personal address. But we know that they are fighting us. But tonight I want to be able to, you know, deal with the enemy that we know the address. The one that we can find. The one that we can locate where he or she lives. In the book of Matthew, chapter number 10, verse 32, Jesus said something like this: whosoever therefore shall come firstly before men, him will I come first also before my Father which is in heaven. But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven. Verse 34 says, think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. For I am come to set a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Verse 36, a man's foes or enemies shall be there of his own household. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. He that findeth his life shall lose it. And he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it.
Dziesiąty rozdział Biblii Mateusza, 32 werset. Każdego więc, który mnie wyzna przed ludźmi, i ja wyznam przed Ojcem moim, który jest w niebie. Ale tego, kto by się mnie zaparł przed ludźmi, i ja się zaprę przed Ojcem moim, który jest w niebie. Nie wniemajcie, że przyszedłem przynieść pokój na ziemię. Nie przyszedłem przynieść pokój, ale miecz. Bo przyszedłem poróżnić człowieka z jego ojcem, i córkę z jej matką, i synową z jej teściową. Tak to staną się wrogami człowieka do mównicy jego. Kto miłuje ojca albo matkę bardziej niż mnie, nie jest niegodzien. I kto miłuje syna albo córkę bardziej niż mnie, nie jest niegodzien. I kto nie bierze krzyża swego, a idzie za mną, nie jest niegodzien. Kto stara się zachować swoje życie, straci. A kto straci życie swoje dla mnie, znajdzie.
I now, from when I read this passage of the scripture,
I kiedy czytam ten fragment pisma,
I stop blaming the Pharisees and the Sadducees who wanted to beat Jesus up.
Przestałem winić faryzeuszy i saduceuszy, którzy się przeciwiali Jezusowi.
Before I used to be angry with them.
Wcześniej zwykle się na nich złościłem.
You know, they want to kill Jesus, they say he has a demon. Possessed with the biggest demon in town. But if you were in the church of Jesus Christ, and you heard a sermon like this, that the one who is called the Prince of Peace, he said, I did not come to bring peace. Then, you know, I think that I don't blame the Pharisees too much, because this is strong. It's difficult to understand that he said he did not come to unite, he came to scatter.
ale przyszedł by
set the mother-in-law against the daughter-in-law,
aby
son against the father,
syna przeciwko ojcu,
the daughter against the mother. Now, when you look at this, if you don't understand it with the context, it would look like it contradicts the word of God. But there is the verse 36 that it says, a man's enemy are the men of his own household. So Jesus says, your enemy is not from the outside, it's from the inside. A man's enemy are those of his own household. You know, during the classes on Monday in one of the when I was teaching in the school, one of the students stood up. She wanted to go. I've been thinking about this all the week. And she wanted to go, so I said, why are you leaving? And she says she wants to have, you know, she's selling her car. She's selling her car. So she has an appointment to meet with the buyer.
I said,
okay, no, that's a good excuse.
You
know, go, you will sell your car. I wish you luck. And she didn't go again. And she was trying to explain to me something. Because she's not able to speak English fluently. We start Googling. She was trying to tell me that she cannot say thank you. Because I wish her luck. And we were there for the next, you know, like 10 minutes, and she's trying to explain to me why she can't say thank you. Until the director was coming to class. And then, you know, she has to speak with the director. And the director has to explain to me that she's just saying that she can't tell me thank you. Because if he tells me thank you, it becomes like a jinx, I guess. For her, she might not be able to do what she
needs.
That is, it is a culture. I went home thinking about that for the whole week. A man's enemy are the men of his own household. And so what I'm trying to bring up here, I will come back to that. What I'm trying to bring up here is that Jesus said the enemy that we have, our number one enemy, is from the house. And Paul called these particular enemies strongholds in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 to 6. You may write it down for references, though, because I want to move. I mean, this is like a revision tonight. I want you to be able to go back and read in your Bible and see whether the things are there like that. Jesus called them household enemies. Paul calls them strongholds. So these household enemies are strongholds. All 45 areas of our life where the enemy finds safety. And the stronghold can be from the family line. Strongholds can also be ideology. Anything you constantly hear, you will end up believing it. Strongholds can be an idea inside your mind. That would be your household enemy. When I hear that cultural concept that if somebody says, I wish you luck, you cannot say thank you, no, I find out that it's just a concept. Because if a prophet were to speak to you, you're supposed to agree and say amen. I was telling her emphatically, like I told the other lady in the class, go, you will sell your car today. I was speaking from my apostolic and prophetic position. But because, you know, of cultural, you know, stronghold, she couldn't say yes. Or couldn't say thank you. So last Sunday, I deal with strongholds from the family. And I try to show how that stronghold works. I believe that there would have been, it would have been recorded, so I'm not going to go into details. I can move on tonight. I'm just going to try to revise it and build on that. We did the analysis of the life of David. The Bible says David is a man after God's own heart. Somebody who loves God and is passionate for the things of God. Somebody who's completely sold out for God. But when you look at the life of David, some things happened that David himself did not understand. And when we analyze it, we try to find out why those things were happening. We started from the, you know, him being from the tribe of Judah. The Bible says that in the book of Genesis, chapter number 49, when you read from verse 8 to 10, every person that God creates in this world, he creates for a purpose. If you, you know, if there's nothing that you understand tonight, know that if you're alive today, God has a clear-cut plan for your life. You are not an accident. You are not an accident. If you are in this house today, God has a plan for you. He created you for a purpose. The greatest tragedy of life would be for you to live here and never find your purpose. He said to Jeremiah, before I formed you, I knew you. Before I created you, I knew you. I made you a prophet to the nations. So every person has a purpose. What will need tonight? Every person has a purpose. It is for you to discover and live according to that purpose. You know, sometimes, you know, folks wonder, you know, why would you just walk out of everything you built for the last, you know, years and just get to another place? It's about purpose. It's not about convenience. It's about living on purpose. So for Judah, who is the grandson of the great grandson of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, then Judah. God created him, you know, with the responsibility to bring out leaders in the nation of Israel. You find that in Genesis chapter 49, verse 8 to 10. Read it at home. We took time to do that this last Sunday. But Judah did not understand his purpose. When you live without the understanding of the purpose which God has created you, you live your life carelessly. And so the Bible says in the book of Genesis chapter number 38, that Judah went to visit a friend. And maybe from Gdansk. When he got there, he just find this, beautiful lady. And before anything could happen, they were living together. There was no proper marriage protocol observed. There was no marriage rites performed according to the Bible. They lived together and they began to have children. They have three sons. And the Bible says the first son is grown up, took a wife. He was so wicked that God killed. And Judah told his second born, take your brother's wife so that you can have sons for your brother. And Judah, that son knew that the children would not be his. He used protection. God killed that one. And Judah was left with only one child. Judah told his daughter-in-law, go home and stay with your people. When this last born has graduated, you come back and marry. Over the years, that did not happen. And one day, somebody told that daughter-in-law, your father-in-law is coming into town for business. And the Bible says this lady removed the widow's garment. I put some miniskirt, some manicure, pedicure, hair cure, all the cures he cured me for. And he stood at the train station where, Judah was coming down. And when I read that scripture, something inside me informed me that the daughter-in-law knew something about Judah that no other person knew. And this thing was this, that Judah does not have the capacity to resist anything in sketch and love.
Że Hilda nie może się przeciwstawić jakiejkolwiek pięknej kobiecie w milion sali.
And so the story says in the book of Genesis 38.
Historia Księdza Rodzaju 38.
That when Judah came down from the train.
Kiedy Hilda wyszedł z pociągu.
With his briefcase.
Z jego walizeczką.
For a business meeting.
Na spotkanie biznesowe.
Find this lady standing.
I znalazł kobietę stojącą.
He didn't go for the business meeting again.
Nie poszedł na spotkanie biznesowe.
We know that he hooked up with the lady. And they start having coffee. And they end up somewhere that they shouldn't have been. And Judah said, I'm almost there. I'll see you some other time. And the lady said, it's not like that. You have to drop something with me. Judah said, no, I will send it to you by Western Union. The lady said, no, we don't do Western Union business. You have to drop something. And the Bible says Judah dropped his bracelet, his staff, and his signet. I said last Sunday that every time you get involved in illegal, illicit sexual relationship, you lose your staff, you lose your bracelet, and you lose your signet. Your authority in Christ, the fruit of the Spirit, and the power of your tongue. You can shout the name of Jesus Christ 20 times and demons will still be standing there because you've lost the authority. Anyway, Judah finished that business and laid those stuff there and went back. A few months after, The family sent for Judah.
Rodzina posłała po Judę.
And they say, your daughter-in-law is pregnant.
Powiedzieli, że twoja synowa jest w ciąży.
And Judah get upset.
I Joda był niezadowolony.
And said, how can she disgrace the family like that?
Ona może skamić w ten sposób rodzinę.
And when they went there,
i kiedy oni tam przyszli,
they called up the lady.
Zawołali kobietę.
And they said to that lady,
powiedzieli do niej,
who is responsible?
Kto jest odpowiedzialny?
The lady said, well, I didn't actually know the name.
Ja nie znam jego imię.
But he gave me something to keep. He never came back.
Ale on mi zostawił coś do.
And they said, bring those things. When they brought the signet, the bracelet, and the staff, it belonged to Judah. There was an incestuous relationship. Now, what I'm driving at, you know, is a revision of what I said last Sunday, just to lay a foundation for those who are hearing for the first time. Now, a child from that kind of relationship is called a bastard.
Dziecko z tego rodzaju relacji nazywa się wnukawe.
Deuteronomy 23, verse 2.
Piąta Mojżeszowa 23, 2.
23, verse 2, the book of Deuteronomy.
23,
I also said that something that God will never change his word because of anything.
I też powiedziałam, że Bóg nie zmieni swojego słowa z jakiegokolwiek narodu.
You know, over the years some people said, you know, God understands. I came, I have a very important announcement. The only thing that God understands is his word.
Ja mam takie ważne ogłoszenie dzisiaj.
If God understands, but it's his word. He will never break his word. No matter who you are, no matter, you know, where, he will never break his word. And God's principle concerning the bastard is stated in Deuteronomy 23, verse 2. It says a bastard cannot enter into the congregation of the Lord for 10 generations.
Bezkrat nie wejdzie do zgromadzenia Bożego przez 10 pokoleń.
So now, somebody whose responsibility to produce leadership, the king, and ultimately produce Jesus Christ the Messiah, has produced a bastard.
Ten, kto miałby liderów produkować, i aż do linii Jezusa, on tutaj wytworzył bezkrata.
You know, people used to argue when you read the book of Job. The Bible says, and the sons of God gathered. And Satan was also in their midst. He was like, okay, the sons of God are here.
And
Satan was being sure
of.
You know, I used to wonder, why did God say, hey, get up with it? But you know, later on I understand his ministry.
Jego służbę,
that in the court of heaven,
że w niebieskim sądzie,
you have the judge,
masz sędziego,
you have a prosecutor,
masz prokuratora,
and you have an advocate,
masz
or a lawyer.
Masz prawnika, adwokata.
These three people must be complete before any case.
Or any judge.
If God is the almighty judge,
jeżeli Bóg jest wszechmocnym sędzią,
who is the prosecutor?
To jest prokurator.
The Bible calls him the accuser. So in the court of heaven,
w niebieskim sądzie,
I believe that the prosecutor,
wierzę, że ten prokurator,
came to God.
Ten prokurator przyszedł do Boga.
My Lord Almighty.
Panie Wszechmocny.
Your Lordship.
Wasza Wysokość.
Concerning the case.
Odnośnie tej sprawy.
Of the man who you said will produce the Messiah.
Człowieka, którego powiedziałeś, że z niego będzie Mesjasz.
I want to submit to the court of heaven.
Chciałbym w niebieskim sądzie złożyć.
That's the man.
Że ten sam człowiek.
Has produced the bastard.
Wytworzył tego pechaka.
According to your word.
Zgodnie z twoim słowem.
You say.
Ty powiedziałeś.
That if somebody produces a bastard.
Jeżeli ktoś,
you will not walk with that person until 10 generations.
Bękata, nie będziesz z tą osobą chodził przez 10 pokoleń.
So my Lord, I want to submit. Concerning Judah. That your program for him.
Że twój program dla niego.
Is suspended.
Będzie zawieszony.
for 10 generations.
Na 10 pokoleń.
Thank you, my Lord.
Dziękuję, Panie.
And because God cannot break His word,
I ponieważ Bóg nie może złamać swojego słowa,
His prophetic program,
Jego proroczy program,
His purposes for Judah,
Jego cele dla Judy.
I'm talking about Judah, but also think of ourselves. Because God has not also changed. You know, but sometimes we think that the God of the Old Testament has gone to university, has improved.
And
he comes to the life of the New Testament. Even the New Testament tells us that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He does not change. His principle remains the same. So God's program for Judah has to be suspended. For 10 generations. We saw that in the book of Matthew. When you read the book of Matthew chapter 1 from verse 1, it says the book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of Abraham, the son of David. And when you count from Judah, which is in verse 6, to David, it will be 10 generations.
Judy, który jest w 6 wersecie do Dawida, jest dokładnie 10 pokoleń.
So now God could not walk with Judah to fulfill his purpose.
Aby wypełnić jego cel.
Because he has produced a pastor.
Ponieważ on wytworzył.
God has to put his plan on hold.
Więc Bóg musiał zawiesić
for 10 generations.
Na 10 pokoleń.
So after 10 generations,
po 10 pokoleniach,
David came up.
Pojawił się Dawid.
God said, now I can resume my plan.
Teraz mogę mój plan.
So David became the king.
Więc Dawid stał się królem.
You know the story of David.
Znaczy historię Dawida.
The Bible says he's a man that loves God.
Człowiek,
if you ever read the book of Psalms, you will know that this guy is passionate for the things.
Kiedykolwiek czytasz się Psalmy, to będzie wiedzieć, że on jest pasjonatem rzeczy, że szczerze Boga uwielbia.
But there is something that I saw.
Ale jest coś, co zauważyłem.
That flabbergasts me. That shocks me. The Bible says, you know the story of David, how David, Saul pursued David in the wilderness,
he struggled.
After everything, God has confirmed David the king. Let me just read this one. 1 Chronicles chapter 14.
Pierwsza
Kronik,
14.
Pierwsza Kronik, chapter 14. Versety 2 i 3. Are you there? Are you there? For his kingdom was lifted on high because of his people Israel. Look at verse 3. And David took
more wives.
It's not in your Bible. And David became more spiritual. He went into 40 days
fasting.
Once David, all that time he was suffering. But now God has confirmed. He's been anointed 3 times. He's on the throne. The first thing he did, he collected wives. It bothers me. You know, sometimes, you find out that folks come to church. And they're very spiritual. Once the blessing comes, Pastor, it is the job. Okay, it doesn't happen here. People here, they are very wonderful. But where I come from, folks that come to church, they have one wife. Once the breakthrough comes, they have many wives. They begin to do things that you never thought they can do. When they were suffering, they were very spiritual and sanctified. Once the blessings of God come upon them, they manifest characters and natures you never know that they have.
I zamanifestowali charakter, na które nigdy nie podejrzewały, że miały.
And the Bible said that, you know, once David finally had been confirmed as a king, he's seated on the throne. God has blessed him. The next thing that he did, he took wives. Somebody said, household enemies. It started in Judah. It's growing. So he had wives. And the Bible says, with all these many wives, David was still in Christ doing things. He was still coming to church. He was still pushing. Because truly, David loves God. He's not doing it to despise God. He's not doing it because he wants to become an unbeliever. He truly loves God. But there is an enemy in the house that David did not know. So the Bible says, one day the satanic, you know, organization, they hold a conference. They had night prayers. And the prayer was focused on David. How do we pull David down? We have made him to take over. It has not disturbed him from serving God. How do we deal with him? After the prayer and the research, one unconfirmed demon stood up and said, I know how we can deal with David. He said, what? He said, I know. He said, tell us. He said, David is from the tribe of Judah. He said, ah, we all know that one now. He said, David is a popular, he's from the tribe of Judah. He said, there is something about the tribe of Judah. Every time they set their eyes on skirt and blouse, they lose control. And they said, thank you for the information. So the next day, David is on his upstairs building, on the balcony. Go read the Bible. He's thanking God for all the money. On that same day, Bathsheba refused to bathe in the bathroom. David was in the spirit. And when he looked, somebody is bathing. And he lost control. He sent for that woman. They told him, it's one of your officers' wife. He said, don't worry, we'll talk about it later. You know the story of that story, you know, he slept with that woman, ended up killing the husband with the many wives. With the many wives that he has. What is the problem? Enemy in the house. A man's enemy are the men of his own household. Something was fighting David, but David did not even know where he was coming from. And so this journey is to make you identify what is making the prayers not to work. It's to make you think. It's a brainstorming session to make you think out of the box. Because we know the name of Jesus is highly exalted above every other name. It's the most powerful name. Everything in heaven and earth beneath the earth bows before the name of Jesus. We know of the truth that the blood of Jesus Christ is powerful, that he has said it is finished in the cross, but it seems not to finish in us. That's what this journey is all about, to make you identify the enemy in the house. So David did not know, but when that happens, then he realizes it.
Wtedy zdał sobie z tego sprawę.
When you read Psalm 51,
kiedy przeczytasz Psalm 51,
say, in sin did my father and my mother conceive me.
Rzekł, poczęła mnie matka moja.
David was saying, have mercy upon me, O Lord, according to thy loving kindness. According to thy tender mercy, blot out my transgressions. In sin did my father and my mother conceive me. So once David realized that this is not what he plans to do, there is something that is working. So David legally married that woman. But God killed the first child while David was in fasting.
Dlaczego podczas gdy
for that same child.
O to samo dziecko.
After they legally married.
Potem jak legalnie poślubili się.
I don't even want to talk about the children of David.
Nie chcę mówić
o Absalom. Who slept with the father's wife. This, you know. In the stadium openly.
Na stadionie
już otwarcie. Amon raped his, you know, the stepsister.
Amon
zgwałcił swoją. But let me zero in on one person that you really know.
Ale jest jedna osoba, którą tak naprawdę znacie.
Bathsheba's son.
Syn Batszeby.
The son that he gave to David.
Syn, którego dał Dawidowi.
His name is Solomon.
Jego imię jest Solomon.
How many of you know Solomon?
Solomon?
If I have a church and Solomon joins my church, it's good. Nobody by
David.
I just need Solomon family in my church.
I have church growth.
The Bible says the man has 700 wives. And if I think very well, there are 365 days in a year.
Jeszcze sobie taką myślę, jest 365 dni w roku.
Don't try to think. Guinness Book of Record has no good second. Guinness Book of Record. Does not have anybody to challenge him.
Nie ma nikogo takiego, żeby.
Nobody has ever challenged Solomon.
Nikt nie rzucił wyzwania Solomonowi.
Do you know what it means to have 700 wives?
Znasz kogoś, kto ma 700 żon?
Some people have one and they are putting prayer requests every day.
Niektórzy mają wielką i codziennie się modlą.
Accepting prayer, just one.
A mam tylko jedną.
And you're putting prayer requests.
I ma ciągle.
This guy has not 100.
A ten człowiek nie ma tylko 100.
700.
Ale 700.
Official wives.
Oficjalne żony.
And there were 300 girlfriends that were recognized.
I było 300 małżeństw, które były rozpoznawane.
Okay, let me not talk to you. Let me talk to you. 700 wives plus 300 girlfriends. That is 1,000. So if he comes to my church, I don't need members again. No, the issue is, how did he end up with 700 women?
Jak
700 żonami.
A to się zaczęło w
These are what Paul
calls strongholds.
This is what Jesus called household enemies. So when we get back to the context, he said, I came to set the father, I mean the son again, because you know what? For you to break away, you have to have a new mentality. If you still want to follow the same pattern of thinking and living and acting, exactly the same thing that has been happening to you. You know, Jesus came to break cultural and family affiliations that enhance generational curses. Thinking and ideology. Like I was saying, that student said to me, you know, he took extra 10 minutes instead of leaving to explain to me, he cannot say thank you. Because she was going to cancel her car and excuse me to leave the class. And I said, go, you will sell it. And she didn't go again.
I ona nie poszła.
She tried to explain to me that, you know, the reason he cannot say thank you. Because it's culturally believed that she said thank you. It's going to be a bad luck. Hello? It's nothing but a stronghold. Those are cultural strongholds. The whole heart. You know, I was speaking as a, you know, not as a teacher, but, you know, as a prophet and a pastor. She said, I want to leave. I have to go. I want to sell my car. I said, go, you will sell it. She stood back. She said, no, she couldn't say thank you because she believed that it's a culture. If you say thank you, then everything will scatter. But you were supposed to say yes. I said the word. But she couldn't. It's a stronghold. Is exactly a type of a stronghold culturally. So when Jesus says that he came to set the Father, I mean the Son and the Father at variance, because some of our cultural, you know, acceptances and ideology are against the Word of God. We have it in my place, it's not only here. It stays like that. We believe it, but yet it's not from the truth. So a man's enemy and the men of his own household, there are things that are fighting from the house that is capable. If you don't win this battle at the home front, it's not going to be easy for you to win outside. That is why we're talking what we're saying today. You have to make a research. You have to know what is fighting you. What is it that fought my mother to a standstill? What is it that stopped my brother and my sister, my family from, you know, don't you think that they also wanted to succeed? Do you think that the way they are today, that it was a choice of theirs? Every person has a natural inclination to succeed in life. It's natural for them to want to succeed. It's natural for them to want to have a husband, a wife, and keep a family. But it didn't happen. One day, a lady walked into my office. And she was crying. And, you know, they said she'll come and see you. I said, what is the problem? She said, they were suffering. The husband was the only person that was working. So she buys salt, everything the husband buys. Our husband was the only provider. So, fortunately, she got a job. In IKEA, in a furniture company. A company that produces furniture. So, you know, as a lady, she saw a kitchen unit. And she liked the kitchen unit. So she laid it by. She paid it instrumentally. So after about 6 months, she paid it off. And they brought this kitchen unit and installed in the house. And she told me, this is her story. He said, after they brought the kitchen unit in the house, the husband, 2 months after, the husband has been as faithful as anything, became like a dog. She doesn't know, you know, she's coming to ask me whether the problem is the kitchen unit. Because before, is the problem is her having a job. This is a serious matter. She was not joking. She was willing to donate that kitchen unit to anybody. If I just said the kitchen unit is a problem, the kitchen unit will leave the house. Because for her, she did not know what went wrong. And when she was talking to me, I'm just sitting there, I don't know where to start. Her focus is the job and the kitchen unit. So what went wrong? But as I was sitting just thinking, you know, I didn't know, you know, sometimes when you're a pastor, somebody just tell you a story, you don't know where to start, you don't know where to enter. You just need help from God. I didn't know what to answer. And I had myself asking her a question, what about your mother? And she said, my mother is fine. And I asked her, is your mother married? She said, yeah, she's living with a man. I said, okay, she's living with your father. He said, no. He's the, you know, sixth person that the mother is living with. And then I began to ask about, okay, you and this man, how long? It's a period of 3 years. How many children? They have one. Is this your first child? She said, no. This is the third one. So I asked her, what happened with the father of the other children? And she said to me that that's what she's been experiencing. This man, they will love her, appreciate her, but after some time they will change and become like a dog. And so when she comes back, and she told me the story how she came back and meet them, with other women in the bedroom, and she, that's how the relationship ended. And I heard myself asking her, and I said to her, do you think that your mother enjoys living with one man after the other? She couldn't answer. I said, okay. What happened to this man? Says the man just changed. And as I was speaking to her, the Holy Spirit began to show to me that it's not even the man, that there is something wrong here. That wants her to be just like the mother. She's already with two men now. She's about to leave this one for the third one. There's an enemy in the house. So I told her, I said, I'm going to pray with you. Just go back. I said, for you to break this, if you get back to your house and you see your husband on top of another woman, take your husband, throw the woman away. Because when you throw that man away, you're going to go to another woman, and the cycle is going to come. It might be difficult, but that is the truth. There was an enemy in the house. It fights from within. When you know this enemy, it can be a sickness in the family. It fights. It kills within the family. And if you think that it's not going to happen, that you're born, and all of a sudden you find out you're speaking in tongues and it's happening. Because you have to identify that enemy.
Yes.
And deal with it. You have to know the enemy that is fighting you from within.
Yes.
If you don't know it, You're going to be fighting, you'll be trigger, what they call trigger happy. You know, you can take a gun, you know, like a machine gun. You're shooting. And the bullet will finish. You didn't give anything. Because there was no target. You didn't even know what you're shooting. What you're shooting. And that could be a frustration in a believer's life. That you're praying. You're binding the devil. You're casting him out. You send him to the abyss. To the wilderness. And it's just deceived that he doesn't want to go. Because you have not come to know the enemy that is fighting with him. You have to identify what is it that is fighting him. As a person. As an individual. Within the family. The traits are always there. The marks are always there. All what you need to do is to make a research. Go back and ask questions. In the conclusion of this, we will see that the Bible said that Daniel, you know, made a research. Daniel has to research. He finds himself in captivity. He has to make a research to find out why they are there. And when he realized the reason of the captivity, he was able to break down captivity. But the number one thing is to make a research. Go back to your family. Look at your mother's generation. Look at your father's generation. Take a survey of the people around you from the same family. What is commonly attacking them? Because that could attack you. Tonight, I want to conclude with this. That was just a revision. I want to conclude with this. I want to look at the enemy, you know, household enemy when it comes to marriage. You know, civilization, do I call it that? Has made marriage to be very, very light. Marriage is just like this. You can just meet somebody and be married. I love you. We married. Marriage is not something light. It's not something light. But you know, the way we have improved or become civilized. Marriage can just happen like this. I see you're the only sugar in my tea. Every time I see you, there is butterfly in my stomach. And after that, the butterfly become elephants. And you're wondering how it entered. Because you make it so right. Marriage is one of the most spiritual things that any person can do himself. It is not just an institution for procreation physically, but spiritually. It's a sacred thing. It's never to be entered in lightly. You know, it's not about emotions. It's not about figure 8 and 10 and 12 or 20. It has nothing to do with physical beauty. Marriage is spiritual. That's why the Bible even compares the church with marriage. If you really want to understand the import of marriage, read epistles when Paul talks about husband and wife. If you want to understand the role of the husband and wife, look at the church. The picture of the church, because that is the picture of husband and wife. In the biblical concept. So marriage was never to be entered in lightly. But I promise you today is so easy. And what it has done to many of us, it can completely destroy your entire destiny. But the Bible says the two shall become one. Now, whenever there is a marital relationship or sexual relationship, doesn't matter whether you use protection or not, there is a transference from each person. You know, whatever curses I carry, I upload and you upload. Or you, whether you are downloading or uploading, whichever way. Whether you are downloading or uploading, I don't know, but it is an exchange. This is the truth. Because, think of this, the life that we live is physical, there is a soul, and there is a spirit. And all of that, you know, sexual relationship is the only means that light travels from the world unseen to the seen world. Every person you see, no matter how cute, no matter how psychedelic, sorry, no matter how wonderful the person looks, we all came through one way. Every person comes through that way. And whenever there is contraction between two people, there is an exchange between the two people. Whatever I carry, I upload to you, and you upload to me. Not only physically, not only the soul realm, but also spiritually. Let me show you an example. The book of 1 Kings, chapter 21. I'll be closing with this. 1 Kings, chapter 21, verse 25. But there was none like Ahab, which did sell himself to work wickedness in the sight of the Lord, whom Jezebel his wife stirred up.
Nie było doprawdy takiego jak Ahab, który tak się zaprzedał w tym sposób złego czar Pana, do czego przywiodła go Jezebel.
It simply means that, you know, the reason that Ahab was wicked was because he married Jezebel. That's the only reason he was wicked. Came from the only reason that Solomon fell was because of the wise, strange woman. He married in Israel, he was alright. He went and bring the daughters of Pharaoh and the other ones. And the Bible said that man that was in the church, that man who God visited, was now buying down to idols. Marital relationship can destroy one's destiny. I said that again. Who you hook up with in life can decide where you're going to be tomorrow. If you hook up with the wrong person. You know, sometimes, you know, I watch this channel of investigation IG, you know, where, you know, relationship, people are being killed because of relationship. There are people that are being shot dead because of relationship. They would not have died, but they end dead because of relationship. They die because of
animal.
Not because of sickness, but because the married wanted to be the person that they married. The Bible says Ahab became wicked because he married Jezebel. You know, when I read that, I said, okay, let me prove the Bible true. Closing with this.
let me prove that if the Bible is saying the truth.
Because I know that they also had a daughter. Jezebel had a daughter. And let's see the daughter of Jezebel. 2 Chronicles chapter 21.
Versety 5 i 6.
Jeroboam was 32 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 8 years in Jerusalem. And he walked in the way of the kings of Israel, as did the house of Ahab. For he had the daughter of Ahab to what? To wife. The only reason the man was wicked because he married Jezebel's daughter. The mother made the Ahab to become wicked. The daughter made this king to become wicked. Because whenever there is union, the two shall become one. There is transference. You of blood or blood. You know, sometimes my children, you know, they do things. I want to lift up my hand.
Then
you cannot like, you cannot please. It's like you're watching your TV.
Every
play. You see something, they go and you look at it. You just say, stop it. You couldn't shout. Because they are like father, like son, like daughter. We do not only resemble our parents and our family. It's not only the physical DNA that works. There is a spiritual DNA. We carry it. And this is why we must know the truth about ourselves. And then we can deal with it.
I wtedy możemy się z tym rozprawić.
Stań to lepiej, czy na
to? Postań.
Enemies in the house. You know, this session is a session that I ask you to simply go back. Before we end it, just go back. Know your enemy. Go back and find out what is fighting you. What is contending with your life? What is contending with your destiny? So that you can pray effectively. So that you can use the weaponry that is in the Word of God to be able to deal with it. Put your hand for the pastor.